due to technical difficulties. I put up test patterns they used to have up on the TVs after the station used to close down. We've got all one up on there for right now.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. It's always good to come into the house of the Lord. Amen. It's always good to take that time to come and lift the Lord up.
Yes.
Because the Lord has done so much for us throughout the week. You know, that's one thing I never want to ever forget, what the Lord has done for us. And one of the things that the Lord always brings back to me is, Tim, just don't forget. Don't forget where you came from.
Right.
Don't forget that. Don't forget where I brought you from. Don't forget that before you formed in your mom's belly, I knew you.
Right.
That I have a plan for your life. And I know a lot of times, and you know, when things aren't going the way we think they're going, you know, still God still has a plan for your life.
That's right.
And what he wants most of all from us, you can see, you hear the cry of his heart. He wants us to trust him.
Amen.
And no matter, he wants us to have confidence in him. In Psalms 57, verse 7, one of the things it says, and this is amplified, but my heart is fixed, O God. My heart is steadfast and confident. I will sing and make melody. Isn't that something? And the New Living Translation says, my heart is confident in you. In you, O God, my heart is confident. No wonder I can sing your praises. What makes the Bible such an awesome book and so real is you can make it personal.
Right.
See, it's my heart. Mm-hmm. See, it's our decision that we want to follow God. And you can choose every day to get up. I will follow God. You know, when we think about Joshua and Caleb, when they sent the spies in, and you had 10 that came back that said, oh, we can't know. We look like grasshoppers. They got all these giants. You know, Caleb, we're more than able. You know, he had this, we can take this. We can do this because he had confidence in God.
Yes.
And that's where it starts. You know, it starts in believing, choosing to believe that God can do what he says he can do. And one of the things that I study, it's just one of those things that I do in pastimes. Oswald Chambers said, faith is deliberate confidence in the character of God whose ways you may not understand in God. We may not understand, but it's having that faith. It's having that. You know, one song that came to me this morning, we used to sing it when we was kids, is trust and obey. That's it. You know, that if you want to boil Christianity down to just a simple thing, trust and obey. If God asks you to do something, trust and obey. You know, these are just some of the verses. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still and with all who will trust and obey. And the refrain says, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but a smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt or a fear, not a sigh or a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. You know, and there's other verses, and I just go back to that refrain, trust and obey, for there's no other way. That's it. To be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. Now, I drove for years, and I remember being out in Wichita, Kansas, and I had to load the next day, and I went to church that night, and they had a testimony. That's why I love testimonies. You may not know the people, but one thing about testimony, nobody can argue with you because it can happen to you.
That's right.
Right? Now, people can argue doctrine and everything else, but they can't deny that happened. I know what happened to me.
Right?
Right? And so I'm out there, and this young lady, I don't know, she looked like she was in her 20s. Her testimony was a song. You know, some do that. She just sang. She didn't give a speech. And the song was, the safest place to be is in the center of God's will.
Yeah.
I had never heard that song, but I thought, how true. The safest place to be is in the center of God's will.
Right.
Where God wants you at.
Right.
Isn't that, I just think that's just awesome. Dwight L. Moody once said this, you know, God doesn't expect the impossible from us. He wants us to expect the impossible from him. Isn't that good?
Yes.
Isn't that good? I think it's absolutely awesome. And that's where God wants us at. You know, that in Hebrews 4:16 says, so let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we receive his mercy and we'll find grace to help us when we need it most.
Mm-hmm.
That's where I feel God wants us at, is to call upon him. To always realize, you know, we tend to really flip-flop things so bad because we think, well, God can't possibly handle this situation. It's too big. You know, it's something he can't handle. Well, wait, let's go back. Did he handle the last situation for you? Did you get through that last situation? Well, what makes you think you won't get through this situation? The same God that was over here is going to be the same God over here. That's what I love about God. That's what I look at the things that happen in my life, and you think about how, you know, sometimes you just get in these situations, and how did we ever get in this situation, okay? But and which way should I go? How am I going to get out of this? Which way should I go? Jesus made it plain. That people ask me that. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So if I follow the one that's leading the way, you ever notice something? Jesus said, come follow me. Well, if you're following somebody, they're walking in front of you.
Yeah.
Okay? They've already walked that way. See, that's one thing we can. Jesus, I love the fact that, you know, we had God the Father, but when God the Son came, Jesus Christ came, he was a man. So therefore, he understands what it is to be a man. He understands rejection. He understands tears. He understands that some people will believe you and some people won't. He understands that. Some will receive you and some won't. There's going to be some people that when you start talking about God, they don't want nothing to hear.
Yeah.
They don't want to hear nothing about God.
Right.
Well, that's all right. You know, but they can't stop me from praying for them.
That's right.
How can they do that? I don't have to be around them when I'm praying for them. Right? We had a situation. I won't mention the individual's name, but we deal with this person on a regular basis. And this person, I don't know what it is, maybe don't like the way they look or something, I don't know. But every time we have to deal with this person, they're not treat us very good. I mean, nah, it was just like it was always friction there, you know? I don't ever let anybody make me feel small, you know? You know, Eleanor Roosevelt says nobody can make you feel inferior without your own consent, you know? So, and we're children of the King.
Amen.
And you're going to have somebody who's going to step on our head? No, because the Bible says we're the head, not the tail.
Amen.
So therefore, but this lady, and we have to deal with it. It's not like we can't deal with this person, because we have to.
Yeah.
So, but we start praying. See, that's something she probably didn't know we was doing.
Yeah.
You know, but I know we start praying, and we was out there yesterday, and how'd that lady treat us? I mean, it was just like she was our sister or something. I don't know what it was. Yes, she was so friendly and kind, and I'm thinking, where'd that come from?
Yeah.
I know where it came from.
Yeah.
It came from the fact that we was willing to pray for her.
Yes.
Okay? Rather than get mad at her. See, that's where I think the biggest mistake is. Somebody treats us like this way and they're mean to us. We're going to get mean back to them. We're going to go at them. That's the way the world does. But the Bible said, and Jesus made it plain, those who spiteful use them, we're supposed to pray for them.
Amen.
There's something not right if somebody's constantly treating you mean or calling you names. Something not right. Why don't you take the time and pray for them rather than complain about them?
Right.
You know? Yeah. Because I tell you what, when people are mean or they got something going on in their life and they're irritated about, there's something inside of them. And the spirit, they bear witness. I'm telling you, you get two spirits that's opposite each other, let me tell you. I mean, they thinking buck heads, you know. But when spirits agree, you know, it's great. We had a new employee come, and right away, we had never talked to you, but right away, our spirits bear witness. We believers. And you know what? One of the first things said, you know what? Yeah, you're a believer, Tim. Yeah. He says, hey, we're going to pray for one another. We're going to pray on a regular basis for one another. I said, that's great, brother. That's great to have somebody to lock arms with you.
Right.
And we do. That's what's nice about the smartphone. They can send messages back and forth. I can ask you to pray for this, pray for this. And it's great when you got a prayer partner.
Yes.
My mom, and I shared this before, but when I was in high school, she gave me a number to Oral Roberts over there in Tulsa, to the prayer tower. She gave me the number clear back in high school. Okay? And you know what? I put it in every phone I ever got. And I still have that to this day. She said, Tim, if you ever need somebody to pray, and now they've gotten so big you can't always get a real person. You know, they you have to leave your information, prayer requests, but they pray. But once in a while, you break through, and, you know, and because somebody, you're caller 37. Well, if you want to wait to get 37, you can. One day I got caller 7. I said, that's close enough. I'm staying on the phone. I'm just staying on the phone. Because I want, there's something that it's always nice they have the recorded prayers. There's nothing wrong with that, and they do speak scripture. But it's something nice about having a real person on the end of that phone that we can talk. And they're so good, you know, because they're not judgmental. You know, they don't say, you say, how can I help you? What do you want to be prayed about today? What do you want me to join with you? I love that. There's something about that when somebody's willing to take their time, and I love that. That's what I really love about my mom and my aunt. And when I would call down there when mom was alive and aunt was alive, and I'd say, Mom, I need to pray. I said, oh, I'll call her. It's Aunt Louise. Aunt Louise said, I'll call her up. I'll call. And they would pray every morning at 5 o'clock. And, buddy, when they got together and prayed, you knew something was going to happen.
Yeah.
You knew something was going to happen. When you get them serious people that can join forces, and I tell you what, that's powerful, because I have always believed that when we pray, I don't believe it stops here at the top of the roof of the church.
Yeah.
Okay? It goes straight to the throne room.
Amen.
That's what we're talking. When you get people that really believe that, when we had growing up, we did have that tearing at the altar.
Sure.
We did have, you know, they didn't have clock. I mean, you had a clock on the wall, but time was an issue.
Right.
You know, because you come down here and we pray and pray and pray and pray till you got that breakthrough.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, if it took an hour after service, that's the way it took. When you talk about changing somebody's life forever, because you never know what that person's going to be.
That's right.
You never know the plans. And I got to share this. I know I get wound up here, but that's, I'm sorry. But I tell you, I got to share this. Some of you might have heard. But when I was a kid, there was a lady in our neighborhood. And I know this day and age had probably been an odd thing to do. But in that day and age, people did it. Now, she happened to be, she was a white lady. And the reason I bring that up was the kids, we used to ride through this one neighborhood on our bikes, and this lady, She would stop the kids in the neighborhood that was driving, riding their bikes through there, and she'd bring them in her house. And once she said, do y'all want to hear the story of Jesus? And she'd bring, and she'd take us down in the basement, and she had these bare rugs, she had to set Indian style, and she'd make you listen to, she'd do the wordless book, and she explained about Jesus. And after they'd have milk and cookies, she wouldn't give them to you, listen to Jesus, yeah. That was all right too.
Yeah.
But she'd go through the wordless book. You know, and some of you are probably familiar with that. You know, and I remember the different colors, you know. Your heart was black, so you had black, and then Jesus' blood would cover it, and then you have a white heart now, you know, and then you have a gold would be heaven. And she'd go through it, and I went through it the first time. I just didn't get it. I came back the next day and says, listen, man, go over it one more time with me. I just want to make sure I got it. And she slowed down with me, and she got it. And at the end of it, she said, do you want to receive Jesus in your heart? If you want to receive Jesus, bow your head right now, and I'll pray with you. And I remember just doing that, and I realized there was something different.
Yeah.
There was something different. And this is clear back in the 60s, you know, and I remember leaving that, and I thought, wow, that's real. And she reached out, and I understand, this in the 60s, this is something you just didn't do.
Right.
She took us nappy-headed kids in there, didn't wear a shirt, hair ain't been called for a week, you know, and go in there. But you know what? That was the first missionary experience I remember. She didn't care. I'm sure the neighbors was whispering about this. Why you take them with kids and little dirty kids in there? Because she was more concerned about her relationship to God and reaching out to others than what the neighbor said. And hallelujah. And that's the way it should be. That's the way it should be. And I remember that house is still there. You know, and I thought, man, I should look her up. She's probably dead and gone now in the 60s. But, you know, what I go by there, that street, and the name was Smiley. I think it was Smiley Lane or Lucky Lane or something. But I remember Linden. It was Linden. I remember going there, and I just remember thinking, I wonder if she knew, now she's in heaven, she knows, that one of those young men that she took into that in the 60s became a preacher.
Yes, amen.
Became somebody that loved God and is out preaching because of her effort right there.
Yeah.
And that some of those young girls came out of there and they became part of choirs.
Yeah.
And they would sing for the Lord. You know, that went far reaching.
Mm-hmm.
That because she was willing to go.
That's
the difference. And that's what God wants us to do. It comes to that point where right now, that, you know, that's what God wants us to do. Not worry about. Because the Bible said, if God be for us, who can be against us?
Yeah.
We're on the winning side.
Amen.
We have God on our side. How can you possibly lose?
Yeah.
You can't. You're on the winning side. So what God wants us today to do is just praise God. Have confidence in Him. Because He will carry us through.
Amen.
And that's what we need to be all the time, every day of our life. Spend time with Him. And when you first get up, there's something about that early morning where the house is not busy, where you spend time with God and say, hallelujah, thank you, guide my day. Whoever I need to reach out to, whoever I need to pray, God, you open those doors today, make a difference, because I am your vessel.
Amen.
I want to be used of you by God. When I was driving truck, I would pray that prayer, and it's amazing how God would get you together with different people. He would you sit down and get something to eat, and this person over there, you know, kind of eyes catch and talk to him, and next thing you know, Jesus comes up. That's what it's about.
Yeah.
It's about giving what you got in here, giving it out. We didn't get saved just to be saved from hell, and that's the only thing we're here for. We got saved so that we can share what's inside of us.
Right.
Because you did not know when it's your last day or that person's last day. A good friend of mine put a message, and their family, that she knows a family, their son had a severe stroke, and he passed away. He was only 40-some years old, and he was gone, you know. And you think, you don't plan on that, right? He's 40, that's so young, but he's gone now, okay? And she wanted me to pray, and I said, you bet. You know, well, I'm not going to put that off till next week. That wasn't a prayer to be it. We're going to pray today, you know. And if God chooses to take him home, and that's what happened, he took home, he's healed now. He's healed now.
That's right.
He's walking around in heaven. He's healed now, all right? However God chooses, And that's one thing we've got to always remember, is that it's all about God's plans. Let him do his pleasure, his will in your life. Don't resist it. Let him do it. Let him flow through you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Prayer request. Yes, Pastor.
Tim, I just want to share something. What you were saying about this woman. Last night, the Lord reminded me of a lady that was our next door neighbor when I was a little kid. And she was a widow, had several kids of her own that she was raised, and she was the town clerk in the whole town that I grew up in. And the son, the youngest one of the family, was in my grade in school. When we first started school, I'd go over and walk to school with him. He used to live right next door, right across the driveway from our house. And I'd go over there, and every morning, she'd pray with us.
Hallelujah.
Now, we were believers. We more deists than we were anything else. I mean, we just believed that there was a God, and you should behave yourself and
right.
Your manners, which us kids did very little of. But we were just kids who, you know, always into trouble and getting into stuff and shit. But never prayed that she would pray for me and her son. Her son's name was Bob. And before school, it always made me uncomfortable because we didn't pray that way at home. We'd say grace, but that was it. We didn't actually have that kind of prayer. Mom would send us to Sunday school, but it was a pretty generic church, you know. Didn't really preach a big salvation message in it. But every once in a while, she'd take me to church with her and her son, and it was a Pentecostal type church. So it was pretty wild. I remember going to summer camp with him one year. It used to be down by Avon Lake, where their church camp was. And I went to the altar. I didn't understand theology at all. I was probably only about 9 years old, 8 or 9 years old at the time. But I remember going down there and thinking, I don't understand this, but I would like it. You know, I would like it to happen.
Hallelujah.
You know, so, and I believe, a lot of times, you know, we say, well, I know I got saved on such and such a day, such and such a time, you know, such and such a place. And that may be true for a lot of people. But I really think, looking back, now I never lived with Jesus after that experience, but I did have, it was a genuine desire on my heart, so I know God wouldn't have turned me down.
Right.
You know what I mean? But because I didn't understand it, because I didn't have any of the word being taught to me after that, I lived my life pretty wild. But that woman, who's now deceased, I know that she prayed for me.
Mm-hmm.
Even knowing all the stuff I was going through, she was the neighbor. She was my mom's friend. You know, they talked all the time. So she knew all the junk that I went through all the time. And I really believe to this day, Pauline Clark was her name, and that she prayed for me. And I really think that that's why my life, not because there were others praying, I'm sure my mother and others as well, but that kind of, you know, I'm 69 years old. That was over 60 years ago, right, when this all first started. And she was, I just know her enough to know that she would have never given up.
That's right. That's right.
She believed that her prayers made a difference in people's lives.
Hallelujah.
So, you know, you don't realize what an impact you can have on a kid.
That's right.
Exactly.
Hallelujah.
You know, they may not understand the theology. They may not be able to sort it all out. But you can impact their lives. The Spirit knows. The Spirit
can
still connect with that little kid and affect them throughout their lives because of God honoring that other person's faith.
Amen.
Until he can bring you into a saving knowledge of the same thing. So that's a powerful testimony that you mentioned with that woman. And I've thought about it over the years. Many, many times it's come to my mind. And I thought last night when it came to my mind, just out of clear blue, God just reminded me of it. And the first thing I thought of was the scripture, this great cloud of witnesses.
That's right. That's
that
right.
That lady that was teaching you the story of Jesus, Pauline Clark with me, and I'm sure all of us have had some kind of interaction with people over the years. They're seeing this.
Yeah.
That's right.
Don't think they're not celebrating, excited about seeing. Now, they may not have seen everything come to pass in their life, but they're seeing it now.
Oh, yes.
And they're rejoicing. It says the angels in heaven rejoice when there's a, you know, when someone comes to the Lord. You can imagine what the people that have actually lived this life and prayed for people and just believed, you know, in the face of all the denial that they're looking at, still continue to pray and believe that God's going to do something in somebody's life.
Amen.
So I just encourage you, just like Tim just did. But she didn't let that get in the way.
Exactly.
Right.
I've seen that there's a soul there.
That's right.
That God loves, and sharing her love, you
yes.
know, with us. So.
Amen.
And you can, every one of us can have that same impact. You may not ever get to see the results in this life, but you can be sure that if you pray the prayer of faith, God will honor that in that
yeah.
person's life. It may be 50 years later before it ever comes to fruition. You might not get to see it. But you'll see it one day. You'll be in that same cloud of witnesses as well. We all will at some point. So
yeah.
I just encourage you to, when Tim's talking up here, look, there was a witness with me right away immediately. God said, that's what I'm talking to you about. You know,
yeah.
we forget sometimes
yeah.
how impactful people can be in our lives. Just in simple ways, in ways
Amen.
That, you know, as a little kid, affect you for the rest of your life. You know?
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for sharing. That's good. That's good. Mike.
Yeah, I pray that the Sunday school classes and the youth classes with Suzanne and with Jamie and I, as we work with these youth and these young ones, that they are instilled and that they understand this is how we feel about them. We care about each one of them. Even if they only showed up once, they're still in our hearts and minds that we want them to continue the destiny that the Lord has placed in their life, even though they may not know it now.
Amen. Yeah, that's great. Suzanne?
And I was just thinking, it was 15, 17 years ago, I was teaching Sunday school. The Lord reminded me of a lesson that I did. And, you know, I don't know much about the rules teaching Sunday school, but I have the kids, one by one, come up on my lap. And it was about Zacchaeus, and Zacchaeus gave his heart to the Lord, and so I had them all make a heart. And I said, if you want to give your heart to the Lord, you come sit on my lap, and we'll pray together. And I remember thinking, the Lord wanted them on my lap, so I put my arms around them.
Hallelujah.
And those kids, none of them are here now, but I know that they prayed and they believed.
Yes.
That's right.
They gave their hearts to the Lord that day.
Yes.
And it was His love and His arms wrapped around them. And I just believe that every single of those children, and I don't remember Sheila, I think your girls may have been there, but those kids, they gave their hearts to the Lord.
Yes.
That's right. That's right.
You know, and so you just don't know. You just don't know. It's a neighbor that said, come. And I thought Sunday school was fun, and you got to do cool things, and so I loved it. And then I remember there was a retreat. They had an overhead projector, and they put a picture of Jesus with this crown of thorns, and I just remember weeping at this retreat. I thought it was weird because no one around me was crying. I was the only one crying. And I just remember being so impacted, and we don't know. We just don't know sometimes the impact that, you know, people have on us or that we have on others. And so we have a lot of children that come and go out of this church. And I just ask that all of us pray about how we can plant those seeds in their lives.
Absolutely.
And how we can nurture those seeds to see fruit, even if it's not with our own eyes. But then all those seeds will come to good fruit for the Lord.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's such a, y'all sharing great testimonies, because God's word won't return void. And when it goes out, and that's why it's so important to keep praying for them. You know, we was down at Hy-Vee one time, and a big family came in for lunch, and they put the tables together, and it was probably 20 of them. And what impressed me was that, you know, they all joined hands and they prayed. They didn't make a big spectacle out of it. They didn't bring attention. They just bowed their head and prayed. And I tell you what a testimony that was to those around them. You know, they joined hands because they wasn't ashamed. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, Jesus Christ. So that was a testimony in itself right there in IV. And when we pray for those kids, we're never going to give up. Always remember, when you look at kids, the kids, if naturally things happen, they're going to grow up. And always think about the thief on the cross that repented. Now, brother, we're cutting it pretty close. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was going out in eternity here really soon.
Right.
But you know what? There had to be. I always get a picture. I know I shared it before, but I always get a picture of a grandma, a mother. You know how they used to wash clothes in the old wash? And I always get a picture of them praying. You know, Lord, I don't know where my grandson's at, but I'm praying. They're washing clothes, and the tears are running down the grandma's face and running right into the water. You know, save him. Touch his heart. I don't know what he's done, where he's at. I haven't seen him for years, but save him, because he's worth it. I had an individual come, and he's in his 50s. He was in his 50s, and as I teach, you know, I try to always be encouraging. And I made this statement. I said, you know what? I'll always believe in you.
Right.
I'll always believe in you. And I don't say that just because I'm teaching school. It's because I really believe it. Because that's what Jesus believes in you. He's got a plan. So I'm saying that I believe in it. He says, you know what? I'm 50 years old, and nobody had told me that.
Right.
How could that possibly be when you this small and you're 50 years old and nobody, he had never heard that. I was shocked that some person along the line, and we don't know all the circumstances what happened, but not one person said to that kid, you know what, you're going to make something out of your life.
Right.
You're going to be something. There's a plan. God has a plan for your life, and you know what, I'm going to pray for you. In 50 years, he never heard that. It just shocked me. Because that's what I try to do. And, you know, somewhere along the line, there's a teacher, somebody that believes in you and gives you a vision so that you can do something positive with your life.
Amen.
It may be like a pastor's case or Sunday school or just somebody that said, hey, I want to just take a few minutes to tell you this, that Jesus loves you.
Right.
I tell you what, that'll stick in your – when we sing a song, you know, Jesus loves me, this I know. Man, I tell you what, when we sing that song in Sunday, that sticks with you. And sometimes them old songs, they come back with you in the middle of the night.
That's right.
Sometimes I've heard that. You know, when you think nobody loves me, then that song goes, Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Not just because somebody just said it, because the Word of God says it.
That's right.
Jesus loves me. That is so powerful. Sometimes that's the best thing you can tell a person, because they may not know that.
That's right.
Because some people look at God as if, I want to go to God because all the stuff I've done wrong, he's going to come after me. You know, they don't get the love aspect of it. They don't understand. They say, no, you got God's perception all wrong. Yeah, it's no doubt God dealt with sin, but he dealt with sin through his son. That's what happened. And he's like this. Always tell him, this is the way Jesus died on the cross. You ever notice? I love that. He died like this with his arms wide open. Now, I know this wasn't quite scripture. I got to share this. I'm sorry to keep going on, Pastor. I apologize. But this was one of the truest portrayals, but it wasn't out of the scripture, but it was on a Catholic church, St. Paul, I was up in Philadelphia visiting my daughter. And I never forget, because I stopped on the corner. I went out for a walk, and I stopped on the corner, and I saw on this church that had Jesus crucified. And it had, Jesus was, one hand was like this on the cross, and the other hand was down here with a piece, a dove in it. So he's offering peace. It's like, okay, this is what I'm doing, and this is what I'm offering.
Right.
Okay, will you take it? And I just thought, what a great picture.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. I just thought, I just stood up there and looked, and I said, that's it. This one, I'm crucified. This one I can give you is life.
Right.
It's going to be your choice, okay?
Right.
I was willing to die for you.
Yes.
It's your choice.
Right.
And you want to choose Jesus. You always want to choose him. Okay? And you tell you what, you choose me, you know what I'll live? I will walk with you throughout your entire life. Psalm 37:25, David said, I was young, but now I'm old. David died at 70. So he said, I was young, but now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread. So in all those years, not one time had David seen the righteous forsaken. Not one time. God always came through. Always. Let's never forget that. Hallelujah. Yes.
About that song, when we were little kids, you know, this gal down at the end of the street, that little me
So, yeah. Hallelujah.
Right.
Hallelujah. Yes.
So we prayed Friday night for Evelyn. They had cut her medication in half, and she was very concerned. She called me yesterday and says, I know you guys prayed. She says, the Lord woke me straight up out of a sleep. And she says, like, my heart and everything just felt so much stronger. So
hallelujah.
She wasn't here, but the prayers were here, and thank the Lord for that. And, you know, as we're talking, sometimes we don't like to always pray for people that we hold grudges against or that we have hurt
yes.
us or have
yes.
called us every name in the book. This being the case, this would be J-Lo's dad, Corey. We hadn't heard from him for the longest time since the last incident when he did call me every name in the book. And pretty much cussed me out. We found out that he had been doing meth for the last two years, which explains a whole lot of his behaviors, right? So yesterday, his mom's wanting to get more involved in J-Lo's life, so we took her over there, and he was supposed to have watched her overnight, but circumstances was he had to go to treatment, so I had to go pick her up, and I told Tracy, don't talk to him, don't say nothing to him, just let him put him, you know, and that's where my heart feels. It's like, dude, this guy has done nothing but disrespect me after I've poured my life out to this boy for years,
right.
You know, but I couldn't do that. You have to be kind, and even the kindness of Jesus is there somewhere, and you look at him, and you just feel sad. I mean,
yeah.
You
yes.
feel sad.
Yes.
You know, he's got a soul, and the Lord had impressed me. Oh, probably a month ago, not knowing that he was doing meth, that we didn't know. Nobody knew where he was. His mom didn't know where he was. She had 3 days of dreams that he was dead somewhere, laying dead. But in any case, she's got him home. She's got him in treatment. So let's just pray for him. I mean, you know, when you see this love this little girl has for her daddy.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, the Lord's able to give him total deliverance. That means my daughter needs to be back with him, but yeah, he needs Jesus, and you know, he used to always tell me, you're the only person that ever told me, you love me, you believe in me.
Yeah.
Even when I'm bad, you know, he'd always say, even when I'm bad, you just keep encouraging me and telling me. So we never know, you know, they may go to the opposite extreme, but I'm sure we've impacted his life.
Yeah.
And we just keep him in prayer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, to give him total deliverance and bring him to understand how much Jesus loves him.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
He can be a daddy to his little girl.
Yeah.
Yes, 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 yes. We're going to pray for that. Yes.
I have a testimony. And just because Sheila is talking about the methamphetamine, my first husband that I was married to for 20 years, he was addicted. And he was addicted on meth. But God had set it in me, which he already had told me that he could set him free and that he was going to set him free. And he was delivered and he was set free.
Praise the Lord.
And he had 5 years to be a witness to others that was in his life and to his family. So that's just what I want to say.
Yeah.
Is that God does deliver
hallelujah.
From those addictions.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. He's delivered. Yes.
Just short. All I'm hearing is how much God loves us.
Hallelujah.
And the only way that this lost and dying world is going to hear is just like all of these stories, people reached out to us when we were pitiful, when we didn't want to hear it,
right.
When, you know, that was the furthest thing from our mind. People reached out to us. We have got to reach out to everyone in our path.
That's right.
Because all he wants to do is love us. He
right.
wants to love us.
Yeah.
Amen.
That is so true. Yes. Yes. Yes, Meyer.
Yeah, it's everything's right on. I was writing down something the other day because I felt like, you know, every day, every morning I get up and I said, Lord, I just want to do what you want me to do, what you have planned for me to do today, because I know that I have peace. things about God. Don't listen to the enemy. And so it just stuck in my head for so long. And I'm just like, really? This is tough love, isn't it? So I said, well, all right, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm going to keep going. I went to work, driving the school bus, and speaking of working with kids, it's awesome. But everybody there is just so low-key and wonderful to work with. There's like 15 drivers, and I've been used to working with 50. And the reason I'm saying this is because I went to Ankeny, and there was a lot of people there, and a lot of drivers. And then I went to Bon Grant, and it was like I'm looking for the office. There's a little hole in the wall in the bus garage. But it's like I said, Lord, how did I miss that? How did I miss what you really want? Where you really want me to be? And I started getting frustrated with that. And he said, it's okay. You know, I want to like almost fine tune myself to the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
You know? And anyways, I had a doctor's appointment for my leg. I had a doctor's appointment a week before for my primary, for my 4-month checkup. And he said, I don't want to see you until June. All the lab reports are good.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
A1C is down. You're looking good. You lost 20 pounds. Then I went to my leg doctor on Wednesday. And she unwrapped me and she said, whoa, a lot of new skin.
Wow.
Yeah.
And I'm like, great God. Amen.
Yeah.
And so she was seeing me every week. She was changing it every week. And now she says, I don't want to see you for 3 weeks. I said, 3 weeks? All right.
All right.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
God is good. God is good. Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's, appreciate your story. There's many prayers that would have been said for us that we didn't even know about.
Hallelujah, yep.
Yeah, there's a song, you know, I wish I could hear my mother pray again, but I never heard her once. But that, I mean, you know, the Amish didn't pray out loud, so I know what's, you know, the way she loved me and so forth, that I would just wish that I'd hear some of the prayers that she did say.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I went to Florida as a kid in a Bible school, and the Berkeys, yeah, they had Bible school, and they prayed. And we don't think about what those prayers back there, what they have done in our life, you know, we have no idea.
That's right.
You know, we can just get a kind of a glimpse, you know, but sufficient in today is the evil thereof. So, but many times those ones that we've been around and so forth, and they have prayed for us. Yeah. Now, those prayers make a difference.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Sometimes we've taken the praying too loosely. Well, I just pray for it. Well, hoping that something will happen. No, something will happen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. And I just joy, you know, as my life has been such a, you know, as a loner for so long. And yet, somebody prayed, and I wasn't alone.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, would y'all, got one more.
Yes. Friday night when we were doing house of prayer, as we were doing worship and praying, speak two things to me. And I was going to say something, but in the midst of the situation, we just kept going. When we were done, Susanna asked me if I had anything that I wanted to say. But I told her, no, don't worry about it. It's fine. But now I understand why God spoke those two things to me. The first thing that I heard was, rejoice with one another. And personally, I believe that God might not give me a book, a chapter, and a verse to look, but he gives me keywords.
Yeah.
Because I'm really good at looking things online.
Yeah.
And I use those words that I hear to search for the scripture.
Yeah.
And that took me to Romans chapter 12. In verse 15, it says, rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep, live in harmony with one another.
Yeah.
Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all.
Yeah.
And then the second thing that I heard was, bear each other's burdens.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
And that took me to Galatians chapter 6. And verse 1, it says, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each will have to bear his own load. And then on verse 8. So as I was thinking about that, what I feel God was telling me is that we not only have to show who he is to others because of what we experience, but we also have to be careful in the things that we do, because on the one hand, we have to be representatives of Christ on earth,
right?
But we also don't want to give the wrong impression of who he is,
right?
Which is why a lot of people that do not believe in who God is or that he exists have a bad opinion or impression of Christians, and they think that we are who we know we're not. And it's because of that we have to be very mindful of that, because some of those people that we come across that we testify to, that might be the only encounter they have.
Amen.
With Christ.
Amen.
Before they part.
Amen.
So that's what I was thinking about, and that's where I feel that God put in my heart as we were doing the house prayer yesterday and the prayer bird.
Hallelujah.
Praise
the
Lord.
That's good. That's good. Okay, would you just stand up for prayer, please? Oh, hallelujah. Lord, we thank you that, Lord, for everything that you've done for us. We thank you for your deliverance. That we thank you for your love, how you showed love to us throughout our years, that you brought people in our pathway that told us that, God, that you love us, that told us that you had a plan for our life, Lord. Lord, whether we're 2 years old, 3 years old, that, Lord, you was already drawing us. Your Holy Spirit was already starting to draw us, that you had a plan for us, Lord. Oh, Father God, we thank you for your healing. We thank you for how that you delivered from meth. That you touched the those situations. Rita's ex-husband and how you're gonna do it in Sheila, the father of the granddaughter there. How that you're more than able. God, we know that you are more than able to do that, Lord. Oh, Lord, what a testimony that you come through. Because the Bible says, I am the God that healeth. One that healeth. He's a deliverer. He can turn those situations around that look absolutely hopeless. Hallelujah. But God, we know that you are a God that deals in the impossible. The Bible says, for with God, all things are possible. Not some things, not a few things, but all things. And the Bible said, is there anything too hard for God? Lord, that while we were yet sinners, you loved us. You reached down for us. Just like the prodigal that came home and was going to say to his father, I've sinned. You ran. The father ran and met him. That's how much he loved him. Hallelujah. And he said, "Bring, kill the cat, fatted calf. Put a ring on his finger. Give him his authority back." Hallelujah. Put shoes on his feet. Get some saddles on his feet. We're going to celebrate because the son is home. Hallelujah. And I know that's what he's done to our lives. That he brought us home. He brought us to himself. And that's what it's about. That, Lord, that there's nobody we're going to give up on, because we're going to keep praying. Whether they're 2 years old or whether they're 60 years old. We're going to keep praying. Whoever you put on our heart, we're going to keep believing. Because you have a plan. Oh, I just keep hearing those words. That you have a plan. That there's everybody in this building. God has a purpose for your life. He has a direction that he wants you to go. And he says, come, follow me. That's what it's about. We have a marvelous Father. Wonderful Father. Marvelous God. One who cares about us. Oh, Lord, that you would be with every request. Lord, every unspoken request. Lord, we want to thank you ahead of time for salvation. Saving those that may have hurt us. Saving those that want nothing to do with us right now. But Lord, they can't stop our prayers, because our prayers are going straight to the throne room. They're going straight to you. And Lord, we're going to have some powerful answers, because your word won't return void. Oh, Father God, we thank you for this day that we can praise you. We thank you that you are love. We thank you that you love us with an everlasting love. That love will never, ever end. There won't be a day where you're going to stop loving us, Lord. We thank you for that. And Lord, we're going to give you the praise. We're going to give you the glory. And as we go into the rest of the service, it's about you. The Bible said, if you be lifted up, you draw all men unto you. And we're going to lift you up today. We're going to praise you today. We're going to thank you today. Because you are God. And you are so worthy. So worthy. So worthy of praise. And we thank you in your wonderful holy name. Amen and amen. Okay. Would you please turn off your phone or put on vibrate? Thank you. April 22nd. Women of Influence, Daughters of the King. So, Suzanne, wanna?
So we are going to be hosting our first ever women's conference on Saturday, April 22nd. I am so proud of every woman in this body who has come forward to offer their gifts, their ministry to other women. I know everybody's talking it up. Invite every woman you know. It's going to be, I think, maybe 10 to 4. We'll have more details. We'll have postcards. We'll be getting postcards in the back. So start handing them out. I might make up some flyers that we can start handing out for different places. But I'm expecting that the Lord is going to use every single speaker, that the worship will be blessed, that the time of ministry, that everybody is going to walk away knowing their purpose.
Hallelujah.
And knowing who they are. They are a daughter of the King.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Now the Lord is calling all of the women forth to walk in their purpose. And I'm thankful that our pastor's wife has agreed to close.
let's speak the word, please. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection which God created to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom, revelation, and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Will Brother John and Eric come up to take the offering, please? Thank you. Brother Eric, would you pray, please?
Father, we are so thankful. Blessed day.
Thanks, Lord.
We have complete victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes, Lord.
And we are so thankful and blessed that our grace and mercies are new each day.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Father, please continue to guide us in our walk.
Yes, Lord.
In faith and not by sight, Lord.
That's right. That's right.
Have your way today in this service, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And bless this offering we're about to receive.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Tim.
Bless you.
It's kind of neat that the Esther thing is manifesting so hot in the Jewish calendar right now. It's Purim, which celebrates what Esther did for the nation. So it's all lining up. Last night at the prayer burn, our worship team was released to go out and pray for those in the midst of things. And Tammy and Mike and Suzanne went out and prayed for people and stuff. God was showing up, and it was mostly ladies who were coming forth, so it was just the Esther thing was still going. It's just they were trying to find their destiny. Things are on the move. We're just trying not to miss the Lord going by. We don't want the Lord to go by. We want Him to enter in. And the neat part about it is trying to make and help our people understand that the Lord's just not going outside, going by. He's within them that needs to be released. And it seemed Friday night, the house of prayer here, we were taking care of the situations with our nation's capital. We were taking care of situations praying for our president. And the Esther fast that Lemuego called forth was to help deal with these situations in the nation right now because of witchcraft and everything is trying to rise up against the president and everything else. I thought that it was going to continue tomorrow afternoon as we went up to Heartland, but the Lord released the confidence and the understanding that we dealt with all this on Friday night and we were free to minister to those even up at Heartland last night. So it was a precious time last night. We declared, we bound, we let loose, we set people free, we blessed. And the fire of God, as far as I know, is still burning up there, and we just want the fire to continue here. And the neat part about it is Rick Arrowhead, who's leading the prayer burn up there and stuff, he has a kindred spirit. He knows what this place is. He knows God has placed us here for such a time as this. And I am so proud of this worship worship team is a gem. I don't take them for granted. I could have went up by myself and stuff, but you know what? None of this would have happened without my brothers and sisters standing by our side.
Crazy.
Rick, in time, you'll be with us. He's still in the Arkansas time zone, so he comes back to us and be whole again. We miss you. We're glad you're back. So.
Yes.
Amen. So go for it, Roberto. Let's just slide right back into that river right now.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Father, I'm tired.
and seen his goodness and his love, his grace and his mercy. But the Lord is showing me now, after all this time, that the world needs to see him through you. When people look into your eyes, they need to see the fire of the Lord. Some of us already have the white hair, but that's another story, okay? But when you walk into the place, talking about the train, you remember how a wedding is where the bride comes in and there's this great train following her dress that just like consumes the room. When you walk into a room, let the presence of the Lord upon your life be revealed and released, just like a fragrant offering. When the alabaster box was broken, we're coming into the Women's Conference. I see this coming now. All right? We need to be seen. The Lord needs to be seen through our eyes. The Lord needs to be seen through our breath, heard through our breath. The Lord needs to be known through our presence. It's not about us, but it's about him that is within us. It's time for this church, it's time for the body of Christ to release the kingdom that is within us. Okay? It's been stifled up so long. Friday night, the Lord showed specifically, in the time of Noah, there hadn't been rain on the earth. It hadn't rained yet. The ground was permeated and it oozed up through the ground and fed the plants and the trees and everything else and the waters. But it came forth. It came forth in the time when the rain started. There was never rain before that, as you all understand. How did the rain get there? It took a cracking in the earth, and the pressure of the ground came down, and the water squirted through those cracks and crevices into the atmosphere. Okay? And then it rained upon the earth. Well, so many years, the church has been like this hardened ground, and the Lord is getting ready to crack this ground. And as this ground, as you are getting broken open, the goodness and the kingdom of the Lord is going to be released. And it's going to go into the atmosphere. And the Lord's rain is going to rain upon people around you. No matter who they are, they're going to get wet with the Lord's presence, okay? So release it, release it. And then it continued on last night at the prayer burn. The Lord showed me, just like an egg, there's life inside that egg and it needs to be out. And how does that happen? The egg has to crack. So as things are getting cracked in your life, things are being broken in your life, you will release life. You will release life and life will be coming forth. Life will be coming forth. And just as Suzanne just released it, this is the third part of what's going on in the cracking. The alabaster box, this is getting released right now. The alabaster box that is represented in your life, the Lord wants to break that open. He wants to release the fragrance of the presence. So when we say, I see the Lord, the world needs to see the Lord in us. The world needs to see the Lord in us.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, for your continued everlasting presence. We thank you, Jesus, that you like cracked vessels.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Because they let the light out. Amen.
Yes.
Praise God. We're all a little cracked, praise God, but it's how God gets released. Amen.
Yes.
Give the Lord a hand clap this morning, if you would. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you all. And if there's any kids, they can go downstairs if they haven't already. Thank you, Tim. Appreciate you opening. Great job, as always. Thank you, Mike and the worship team. Praise the Lord. God is good. Thank all of you for sharing your testimonies and prayer requests. And just declare it done. Amen. In Jesus' name, praise the Lord. We're talking about having God revealed and released through us. You know, if you just stay conscious and aware of God, the opportunities are continuous. So you don't have to make a way, you just have to be the way. Praise the Lord, you just have to be available. You know, even the, think in the Aaronic priesthood, how they would bless the people, you know, they would what they did was they would put the people under the name of God. They would, you know, I'm going to do the Spock thing, but that is a Hebrew way of praying for people. That there came a time when they weren't allowed to use the you know, Yud Hey Vav Hey. They couldn't say that anymore, so they would say Jehovah, you know, whatever. And that's what you're doing. When you bless people, when you love people, you're putting them under the name of God. You're putting them in a position where they can be blessed by the Lord. It's really not as complicated as sometimes we make it in our own minds. You and God are one. If you're aware of that, wherever you are, God can be released. It's that simple. We're talking about people that prayed for us. That Tim was talking about the lady that taught him that little Bible story that brought him to Jesus. Amen. Talking about my next door neighbor who, she never, actually, I don't know that she ever really read scripture to me or anything, but she always prayed for me. Always made me conscious that there was a God. She was praying to somebody. I mean, it wasn't like she was, you know, just talking to the wind, but she'd have us bow our heads, me and her son, and she'd put her hands on us and she'd pray. And you know, as a little kid, 5, 6 years old, whatever I was at the time, it affected me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't have any theology. I didn't have any real revelation in that sense, other than it made God real. And that's why we talk about kids going to Sunday school. You know, as long as we're not teaching something that's totally contradictory to the Bible, I don't really worry about it. The truth is, they just need to know that God's real.
Yes.
That there's a real God. Because they're not going to, I mean, I'm talking about the little kids now, they're not going to get the theology. You just confuse them with all of that stuff anyway. All they need to know is, there is a God, and he loves me.
Yes.
He's real.
Yes.
And the Holy Spirit will lead them into the truth as they grow older. The opportunities for the, you know, when they start asking questions, then you know they're ready for the answer. You know what I mean? Unless it's a 3-year-old asking where babies come from. You might have to lie for a little bit, but God will give you grace for that. Praise the Lord. But I'm just saying, a lot of times people ask us questions, and we think because we have a sense of, I don't want to be rude, so I'll just say, a lot of times people are asking questions, and we think we know what the question is, but it isn't what. It's a much simpler question that they're asking than we want to go deep into theology, when the fact is all they want to know is there a God and does he love me?
Yes.
Does he care about me? And, you know, we can go off the deep end and start going into all kinds of theological stuff that doesn't mean a thing to them, and they don't even care to know it. They just want to know that simple reality that, yes, there is a God, and that God cares about you, to the point that he was willing to give his own life or his only begotten son for you to know him, for you to have that relationship. Amen. So, praise the Lord. I want to start in John chapter 4 and just read verses 9 and 10. So John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. And I told Mike I was going to have fewer scriptures, but I lied. Amen. And I think it's a lie, even if you didn't mean it to be one, it still ends up being a lie anyhow. But praise the Lord. You know, sometimes when they say, do these pants make my butt look big? You have an option. Praise the Lord. Sometimes lies are good. Sometimes lies are not necessarily evil. Praise the Lord. I've never asked that question. Maybe I should. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Anyway, we've talked about this over the last several weeks, and we are one with God. The Bible says over and over and over, God declares that he'll never leave us or forsake us. He's one with us. He's not just, hanging around really close to us, but he can't be separated from us. So when we talk about revealing God to other people, again, it's more a question of you being aware that he is with you,
right,
than it is about how you project that to somebody else. It'll happen automatically if you just let yourself be you. I mean, you've got a personality. God loves each one of us uniquely, exactly for us.
Right.
And there's a reason for that, because the people that you can impact are not necessarily the people that I can.
Right.
You know what I mean? We have ways of interacting with people that are unique to us and to them. Personalities and all that stuff plays into it. Tim was talking about, there are some people that just, no matter what you do, they just reject you. Right? I mean, some people, no matter how hard I try to be nice and to get along, they don't want to know about it. They don't want to hear about it. They don't want anything to do with me personally. But that doesn't mean that same person, John, could walk up to him and they'd be totally open to anything that he has to say. You know what I'm saying? Because somehow they would connect in ways that I just can't do it, And that's where the opportunities, when the door opens, that's God, so just let it go. Just be yourself and share what they're able to accept.
Sure.
There's no point in trying to get into all of the depths of doctrine and everything else with somebody who just really needs God, just needs to have an encounter with God, right? He just needs somebody to care, praise the Lord. So anyway, let me move on. And I'm going to meander around here like I usually do. So try to stay focused and maybe you'll get something out of this. I mean, I really think that God's trying to show us something here. And, the degree to which we know God, and by that I mean trust God, is the way that blessings inheritance is meted out or given. In other words, if you only trust God for certain, that's why you go to a certain church, they don't believe in healing. People don't get healed there.
Right.
Not because God's any different there than he is anywhere else, but what they believe is that God is not going to heal because God doesn't do that anymore. So people don't get healed, right?
Right.
And that's what I mean by this. To the degree that you understand God, that you know God, is the degree to which you receive from God. Because he doesn't force anything on you, right?
Right.
So that's basically what I want to talk to you about. So then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Okay, so she says, why are you asking me for a drink? Because, we don't have nothing to do with each other. I know you're a Jew, I'm a Samaritan, on and on and on. And Jesus said, if you knew who I was, if you really knew who I was, you'd be asking me.
Yeah.
Because I have something that I could give you that would take away your thirst forever.
Yeah.
Okay? Matthew chapter 13 and verse 13. Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they see not, and hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. Okay? So there's a direct correlation between not knowing Jesus well and not asking much of him.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. How many people will be ultimately in heaven and realize how much more blessed their life could have been if they just would have known Jesus well enough to ask for some of the things that they didn't think they could ask for. Because they didn't know him well enough to think that he, she could actually receive it. Amen? If you knew who you were talking to, you would ask me. See, when you really know God, the Word, right? We've been talking about this, okay? You would see that God is a great giver.
Yes.
Over and over and over. The whole Bible is filled with God's grace, with God giving. Amen? And the fact that God is a giver isn't just because he's a giver, but because that gives glory to God.
Yeah.
The fact that he is a giver, the fact that he doesn't, we don't have to earn it, but that he just gives it, brings glory to God. In fact, it says that our testimonies, our lives, based on the grace of God, will declare the glory of God throughout eternity. His giving, amen, defines his glory. Praise the Lord. So look at James chapter 1 and verse 21. James 1, verse 21. Wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. Now, that word engrafted is emphutos in the Greek, and it means to be implanted. It comes from the root word phuo, which means to germinate or to grow. It's a fixed position. It actually says in one part of the definition, give wholly to there, to that position, to that place. It then says a position of rest. Praise the Lord. So everything God wants to do, he wants to do it by his word. The way he does it by his word is planting it in you. Engrafted, by the engrafted word of God, so that you rest and the word does the work. As you trust, as you believe, as you position yourself, amen, God's word comes to you, and then it begins to produce. It's what Jesus was talking about in Luke chapter 8. Let's look at this, Luke chapter 8, verses 8 through 11. Other fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruit 100-fold. And when he had said these things, he cried, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now let me just say, just inject this again. We were talking about before, there's churches, love God, people are saved, they're going to heaven, but they don't believe in healing. Or they don't believe that God really wants to prosper them. It's all a crapshoot, you just don't know what God's going to do and all that kind of stuff. This is, you know, we always talk about the good ground being somebody that doesn't believe in God. Well, that's not necessarily true. This can very well be people that are saved, people that are born again. But they can't receive a word from God because they don't believe that's God's nature. In other words, they think God doesn't heal anymore. It's not about God. God isn't about healing anymore. So therefore, I can't receive a word of healing. It's going to fall on bad ground, on ground that will not produce because it will not take root. It won't be engrafted word. It'll just be a word that comes and goes. The enemy comes immediately and steals it. Amen. Like the squirrels in my backyard eating all the bird seed.
Uh-huh.
As fast as I put it out there, they come and eat it.
but the birds go get another birth. Okay, and bear fruit a hundredfold. And when he had said these things, he cried, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And his disciples asked him, saying, what might this parable be? And he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand. Now the parable is this. And it doesn't get any simpler than this. I know a lot of people think, well, this is old stuff. It may be old stuff, but maybe we ought to be doing it. The seed is the word of God. It's why we have the scriptures that we confess before every service. It's not just a ritual. It's to get us to understand, don't just do this in church. When you've got an issue, when you've got a situation, when you've got a person that has need, you need to pray the word of God over them. Yeah. Otherwise, you're just begging. You're just praying out of fear more than anything else. If you pray the word of God, now you can pray with confidence, and you can come into an agreement with God what God wants to do. The problem is when we start talking about, oh, my God, you know, what's going to happen? My finances. That's not a prayer of faith. That's fear.
Yep.
And that doesn't move God at all. It keeps me in the situation I'm in. It just adds stress.
Yes, it does.
So you need to pray the word, because that's the seed. That's the thing that will produce. Our desires, our wants, if they're not in agreement with the word of God, they're just our desires and our wants. So find whatever your desire and your want is, find it in the word of God and pray that. Because that's what God recognizes. That's what God connects with.
Amen.
And you'll find your prayers will be much shorter and much more effective. Because you don't have to get God's attention. This is God. You're praying God right into that situation. You're releasing God. We're talking about releasing. Well, this is how you release God.
Yes.
By his word. You don't release God by getting excited. I can release as much God without ever raising my voice as anybody shouting and jumping and running. I'm not against any of that. I'm just saying that's a human behavior. That's a human action, maybe motivated by what they're feeling in the spirit, but it's not any more God than just somebody standing up and saying, God wants you well. God wants you healed.
Yes.
Yep.
God wants you delivered. God wants you set free.
Yep.
Praise the Lord.
Glory.
In fact, this is one of the few times that I see where Jesus ever really raises his voice outside the time he upsets the tables in the temple because of the money changers' death. You know, we talk about the anointing. There was nobody more anointed than he. He was the anointed one. He is the anointing.
Right.
And he's not shouting and screaming a heck of a lot.
He does, it does say that he cried out here. So it must have been something pretty important to him. Right?
So the word is seed. And that seed is for whatever you want to manifest in your field, in your life, in your place of influence.
Come on.
The scripture says, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Religiously, we always say, though, that's because if you do bad, you're going to get bad. Well, it could be that, but it's also whatever you're declaring
yes.
is what's going to come back to you.
Yes.
You have authority.
Yes.
And whether you know it or not, or whether you realize it or not, you're exercising authority every time you open your mouth.
Amen.
Words have meaning. Words have value. Words have power. Words are what show authority. Authority, excuse me. Now let me show you something that goes with this, Luke chapter 8, where Jesus is talking about the seed. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 29 and verse 29. Deuteronomy 29, 29. The secret things belong unto the Lord. Now, what did Jesus was saying, you know, they've got ears, but they're not hearing, and there's people that are, you know, have eyes, but they're not seeing. So I'm telling this, I'm telling parables. This is for you to know. Why was he saying that? Because they were part of the kingdom.
Yes.
Right? They were already part of what God was trying to do.
So he says the secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and to our children forever, that we may do, not hear, not see, but that we may do all the words of God, or all the words of the law. Amen? All right, look at Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 11 through 15. For this commandment which I command thee this day, it is not hidden from thee, neither is it far off. It's not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who shall go up for us to heaven and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. This word he's talking about, right? Neither is it beyond the sea that thou shouldest say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. But the word is very nigh unto thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it. See, I have set before thee this day life and good, death and evil. Now, the interesting thing about this is, look at Romans chapter 10 and verses 6 through 10, and you'll see what we're talking about when we say Jesus and the Word are the same thing. In the mind of God, they're not different. They're the same. Because he said, but the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above. Right? Mm-hmm. Instead of the word, he said Christ. Who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? This is what the righteous say. In other words, those that are born again, those that are in the kingdom, those that are one with God. What do they say? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And you can say it, everything in the word of God works on this principle.
Yes.
Yeah.
When Paul said, having begun in the Spirit, are you now thinking that you're going to be able to bring about all of this reality through your flesh?
Right.
Righteousness, or the spirit man, says, what God has said is what I declare, because that's the only way I can get it. I don't need to pray Jesus down again from heaven.
No.
I've got Jesus.
Yes.
Very nigh to me. In fact, even in my mouth. Amen. And when I speak it, I release Jesus.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. We go through a lot of religious mumbo-jumbo, and the truth is, every time I open my mouth, as long as I'm not in disagreement with the Word of God, I'm releasing Jesus.
Yes.
I can't do anything else because I'm full of Jesus.
Yes.
He and I are one.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Proverbs 4 says, attend to my words. They are life and health to all thy flesh. You got sickness in your body? You ought to be saying what the Word of God says. The Word of God, attend to that word, because that is healing and health to all of your flesh.
Yes.
Now, I'm not telling you don't go to the doctor. I'm just saying if you go to the doctor and you don't do this, you're just taking a shot that that doctor knows more than most of them know. This will heal you.
Yes.
It's a promise from God. They're practicing medicine. God has perfected it.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We don't have to go anywhere to get Christ to come.
No, we don't.
The word is right here.
Yes.
In your mouth. Speak it.
Yes.
And Jesus will sozo. Jesus will make you whole. Jesus will do whatever it is you got to have done.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. All right, let's go back to where we started again now. John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. I want to just go back over these scriptures real quick just to make them fresh in your mind again. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which is a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Matthew 13:13. Therefore, speak I to them in parables, because they see not, and hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. So here's the deal. We've got two kinds of eyes. Eyes of the heart, which are the eyes of the spirit, and eyes of the head.
Sure.
Paul prayed in Ephesians 1:17-18 that we would have the eyes of our hearts, our spiritual eyes, enlightened, that we may know what is the hope to which he has called us.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is a scripture that we started when I first took the church, when we were still out on the south side. Suzanne can tell you we were having Bible study, and Wednesday night there was like three or four of us getting together. These are some of the scriptures that God gave us. Did I understand everything that he was trying to tell us? No, I didn't. I didn't have a clue, but I thought they're good scriptures, but why wouldn't we use them? But God was trying to show us where he was taking us.
That's right.
Come on.
So I don't take it lightly when I talk about these things, because I know this is where God has said all along he's trying to get us to.
Come on.
Yeah. If we'd have tried to do this then, it wouldn't have happened. Nothing would have happened.
Right.
It would have just been us verbalizing something that we're reading off of a page instead of something that had been engrafted.
Right.
Something that had been sowed into us. Amen? So, there's a kind of knowing or kind of seeing that comes through these eyes, the spirit eyes that I'm talking about. And it's different from seeing what comes through the eyes of the head.
Mm-hmm.
David described a connection between this inner blindness and idolatry. In Psalms 135:15-18, he said, idols have eyes, but they don't see. And those who make them become like them. Idols are dead. They're just a thing. They're just a statue. They may have eyes on them, but they can't see. They may have a mouth, but they can't speak. They may have ears, but they can't really hear. And he said, people who operate like that, people who connect with that, make themselves like the idol.
Yes.
Eyes they have, but they can't see. Ears they've got, but they can't hear.
Uh-huh.
In Revelation 3:17-18, Jesus said, buy from me salve to anoint eyes so that you may see. If you go back and read that, you'll see that he was talking about, you know, you say you're wealthy and you're rich and you have need of nothing and so on and so on and so forth. He wasn't saying wealth is bad. He wasn't saying you shouldn't, you know, have be prosperous and so on and so forth. He's saying those have become your idols.
Yeah.
Amen? And because of that, you're not hearing me. And you're not seeing me. He said, you need to buy from me salve for your eyes that you may see. Divine salve. And that's exactly what Paul was praying for in Ephesians 1:18. Eyes of the hearts being enlightened to know our hope, our inheritance, and our power. We have to have the gift of spiritual sight. Why is that so important? Because spiritual seeing is the act of the spirit that corresponds to revelation.
Yes.
Because you can hear, I can have a revelation, you may have a revelation, this person may have a revelation, and they can tell you about it, but that doesn't mean you get revelation because they told you.
Right.
It's your spiritual sight that causes it to be revelation. Amen. That's why things get repeated. That's why by hearing and hearing and hearing by the word of God, people get transformed. Why? Because the first time they hear it, it may not be revelation at all. It's just more information.
Sure.
But one day you may just be sitting alone at home and or somewhere and reading the scripture or listening to a CD, and all of a sudden you go, oh my God.
Yeah.
Where have I been that I didn't know that? You know, you heard it, you testified to it, you've read it, you know, all that, and then all of a sudden, bam!
Yeah.
Come on.
All
the Spirit connects.
Yes.
And what has just been information or good-sounding doctrines or whatever, all of a sudden becomes a revelation.
Yes.
And see, once it becomes revelation, it is engrafted.
Yes.
Now it can't be taken from you. Now it becomes a part of you. Now it can produce something. So just because we have the word, just because you go to a church where they preach, doesn't necessarily mean, amen, that the word is going to produce what it's supposed to produce. It can be the word, but it doesn't necessarily have to be the engrafted word. Because I'm looking at people. I mean, I know when I used to preach for Brother Butcher, when we first come up here to Iowa, I've known John and Sheila since then, whenever that was. That was, what, 30 years ago almost now? And I was preaching stuff that was biblical, that was Bible. But it wasn't any more revelation for me than it was for half the people I was preaching it to. Because we had a mindset that this, you can't get past this. I remember preaching one time at a minister's conference, in fact, at Calvary Tabernacle, and I had everybody there, and I won't say what I want to say, angry with me. I mean, every preacher on that platform turned away from me, except for Brother Butcher, who to this day I respected him and he's a great guy. Now, we disagreed on a lot of things when it came to theology, but he was a man that loved God.
Right.
He came to me afterwards and he said, "Brother Nathan, pray for me." This guy had been pastoring for years. I was like punk. I was just a kid, you know, but in comparison. And I preached a message about the woman with the issue of blood who had... or not the woman with the issue of blood, but the Samaritan, or not, well, I can't even think of the
Syrophoenician?
The Syrophoenician woman, yes, who had no right to healing. She wasn't Abraham's child. She didn't have a right to come to Jesus. She didn't have any of this. But by grace, I'm talking 40 years ago now.
Yeah.
Well, 30 years ago, I guess, yeah. Sorry, my math isn't that great, but. You know, the ratio of an igloo's circumference to its diameter is Eskimo pi. So that's where I go with the... I'm just saying, 30 years ago. And it irritated them so much that I was saying that God just loves people, even if they're not us.
Right.
So, anyway, praise the Lord. When we let ourselves relax, God will speak.
Yep.
If we don't let our doctrine get in the way of the Word of God, God can minister.
Yep.
Romans chapter 8, verses 24 and 25. See, we need to see with spiritual eyes. Mm-hmm. We need revelation. Nothing wrong with information, but information will not get you any further than where you are right now. Revelation is what will change the environment, the situation, and the people that you're interacting with. We're saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. All right, go back to Romans chapter 5 and verse 2 now. By whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. All right, so remember, Jesus and the Word are one. Jesus came into this world to pay for our spiritual blindness. We were cut off from the Spirit. We were dead spiritually. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. 2 Corinthians 3, 13 through 18. Not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. the blindness is done away in Christ, right? But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. And I said last week, to do that and see us, to do that and be looking at us is pathological. We're looking to Jesus. Our transformation takes place without us having to do anything other than to behold.
Right.
To see with the eyes of the Spirit.
Right.
To not try to make something happen. Turning to Christ, turning to the Word made flesh, God's glory, our sight is restored.
Yes.
That's what he's talking about here. When we turn to the Lord, when we turn and behold the Lord, we are given sight.
Yes.
All of a sudden we see God, and the scripture goes on to talk about us being transformed into that image. We're not doing anything other than beholding. We're not doing anything other than having our spiritual eyes opened,
yes. Yes.
Because of Jesus, so that we can see things the way they really are. Your sight gets restored.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
All with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord.
Yes.
If all you see is your bank account, the doctor's report, the 10 o'clock news, you're seeing through the eyes of your head.
That's exactly right.
Verse 18, we all with open face beholding as in the glory, in a glass the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. We get our eyes open to have spiritual eyes the way Jesus sees things.
Yes.
By the Word, based on the Word. The Holy Spirit, who wakens our spiritual eyes, was sent, the Scripture says, to glorify Jesus, John 16. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will glorify me. Right? So the Spirit will open the eyes of us, all of us, when we behold Jesus, the Word. The glory appears. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 6. 2 Corinthians 4, 3 through 6. If our gospel be hid, is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So we only see in the presence of the glory of Christ.
Yeah.
John 1, 1 through 3. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, the same was in the beginning with God, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Only by the Word does God say, let there be light.
Yes.
To go back to the scripture we just read, right? Keep it in context. When our eyes are opened and the light shines, it's Christ that we see.
Mm-hmm.
Revelation. When God said, let there be light, what was he saying? He was releasing Jesus. Jesus was releasing God.
Yes.
The Word. And what happened? Bang! There's light. Where you couldn't see, all of a sudden now you can see.
Yes.
Our eyes are opened, the light shines, and what do we see? The Word.
Mm-hmm.
manifest. We see Christ.
Yes, Lord.
Yes.
John 1:14. This guy, this word, this man, this God, the word was made flesh, dwelt among us. And what did we do? We saw it. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. We saw the glory.
Yes.
Where did we see it? In the Word.
Yeah.
When we saw it and beheld it, right? The revelation between the Word of God and the glory of God, or between hearing and seeing, isn't some new thing. It's not like it just popped up on us here in the 21st century, or even in the New Covenant. Look at Exodus chapter 33 and verse 18. It's Moses, right? Moses had been talking, God had been talking to Moses, and Moses says, I want more.
No.
I beseech thee, show me your glory. How did God respond? By a revelation of himself by the Word.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I will make my goodness pass before you. See.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And will proclaim my name before you. Here.
There you go.
Right?
Yep.
Then he did it. Look at Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 and 7.
And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, that will by no means clear the guilty. And I won't go on because that's pre-Christ, that's before Jesus, but it was the condition under the law, right? So he says, show me your glory. And God responds to the deepest degree that he can to Moses' request. Let me see your glory. God proclaims words, the essence of his name.
Yes.
Show me your glory.
Mm-hmm.
So he gives him words, which is the essence of God, which is what God is, right? In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God.
Yes.
So he shows him the Word.
Yes. Yes.
So he sees and he hears, right?
Mm-hmm.
Look at 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 21. And you'll see this is throughout. This isn't just something that's going on now. It's the way God's always done it. The Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh. How? By the word of the Lord.
Yes.
He revealed himself. And he did it by the word.
Come on.
Yes.
What we want is a revelation of God himself. Show us your glory.
Yes. Yes.
Romans 8, 18.
For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed to us. In us.
Yeah.
Hearing and speaking. That's how the glory gets revealed.
Uh-huh.
You hear the word, you read the word, you see the word, you speak the word, and it's revealed in us.
Uh-huh.
Salvation, healing, deliverance, prosperity, all works the same way. See, spiritual sense or perception, however you want to define it, is different from physical perception. But it's not really disconnected from it. It's just different from it.
Uh-huh.
Psalms 34, verse 8. and see that the Lord is good. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Now, we're talking about spiritual perception, right? Or sense. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. So which comes first? Tasting that the Lord is good, or seeing that the Lord is good? Or is tasting seeing?
Yes.
Is the taste the sight?
Yes.
Come on.
God's invisible. See, the difference between physical perceiving and spiritual perceiving is that spiritual perception is the creation of a new taste in the spirit.
There you go.
Taste and see. Praise God. All right. John 4:15 again. John chapter 4, verse 15. And I'll show you how Jesus makes this so simple. The woman saith unto him, Sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. In other words, she's saying, give me a taste of something that I've never tasted. And I'll never have to come back here again.
Come on.
Yes.
See the word. See the word. She saw the word.
Yeah.
Yes.
He said, if you knew who it was you were looking at, who you were talking to, you'd ask me something. Right?
Right.
So you see the word, and then you agree with the word. Right? What did the word say? You'd ask me. Right? So she sees the word, then she agrees with the word. And then what does she do? She speaks the word.
Yes.
Taste and see, and you'll have what you say.
Mm-hmm.
A new taste. A visible manifestation. Yes.
Glory.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste and you get a manifestation.
Yeah. Come on.
See what I'm saying?
Yep.
All right. Hosea chapter 6, verse 3. Come to know the Lord. Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. His going forth is prepared as the morning, and he shall come unto us as rain, as the latter and the former rain unto the earth.
The
know the Lord. How? By the Spirit.
Yes.
When you follow after him, mm-hmm. when you follow the word, when you go to the word, he connects you to it by the Spirit. You get revelation.
Amen.
Believing what you see in the Spirit by the Word.
Yes, yes, yes.
It'll cause what you see to be tangible.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Taste and see.
Yes.
Most of you know this. I'm going to say it again just because it's relevant in this particular moment. When I was diagnosed with hepatitis C, y'all know this, I was going out to the VA, I was getting, you know, liver scans every 30 days, I was getting blood tests once a week, all this stuff, nothing they could do. Eventually you'll have to have a liver transplant if you can get one. I walked a bike path that's just a few miles, a couple miles from our house every day, and all I did, I never told anybody, y'all know this, I never told anybody in the church. I never even told my wife. I walked that bike path every day, 3-4 miles at least, and all I did was read to myself healing scriptures. You sent your word and healed, delivered me from my destruction. By your stripes I was healed. No weapon formed against me can prosper. Over and over and over. I still have some of them stuck on the mirror in our bathroom off of our bedroom. That's all I did. Mm-hmm. I come back, I don't know how long it was, 6 months,
maybe not quite that long. And after I started this, went back out to the VA. My doctor wouldn't even see me. He sent me to the specialist. Got to the specialist. She had all my records piled up on her desk. All the scans, all of the blood work, all the other stuff that had been going on for a year probably. And she said, Nathan, if I didn't have all of this history in front of me, I'd have to say, you never had hepatitis C.
Mm-hmm. Glory.
It's gone. I never had one treatment, because there wasn't any treatment. Not back then. This was 10, 15 years ago, whenever it was. I can't remember now. I didn't do one thing except say what God said about me.
Glory. Glory. Thank you, Lord.
I'm telling you, I know a little something about what I'm talking about here.
Come on.
I'm not trying to be arrogant. I'm not trying to say, you know, my theology. This isn't theology. This is reality.
Yes,
this is a real thing.
Yes,
this is revelation, and you cannot take it from me because it happened to me.
Yes.
And you can doubt me all you want, but I'm telling you, the records are there. The evidence is there.
Yep.
Amen.
And I'm not saying it because, wow, what a spiritual guy. No, I wasn't spiritual at all. I didn't trust other people's faith.
Come on.
Amen.
I'm sorry, but that's the truth.
Amen.
I should have, and God might have done something differently. I love you. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
I love my wife. But this was between me and God.
Right.
And I sensed that from the very beginning of it.
Right. Amen.
And because I put him first and trusted him, he taught me, not only did he heal me, but he taught me something that I didn't know before.
There you go.
Something about him. Something about his word and he being one.
Yes.
Amen.
All the time, I'm walking that bike path and confessing. I had him on little stick of notes. I just read them, flip, read them. God was right there.
Yes, he was.
Yes.
Of course he was. He was in me.
In the word.
But I was releasing him. Praise the Lord. See, I allowed the Lord to create in me a new taste. To experience the glory of God in a way that I'd never experienced it before.
Amen.
All right, we'll wrap up with these last scriptures. John chapter 4, verse 10 again.
Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water.
Ask me the word, right? Ask me the word, all right? Verse 15.
The woman said unto him, sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw.
Taste. Verse 29.
Come see a man. This is her now. She's tasted.
Yeah.
Come see a man which told me all things that I ever did. Is not this the Christ? Is not this God in the flesh? Revelation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Ask me. Ask the word. Taste it. And then watch for manifestation.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Because manifestation comes when you get revelation.
Yes,
they're connected. You won't get manifestation for something you don't have a revelation of. That's why it took me 6 months of walking a bike path or 4 months or whatever it was. Because I didn't have revelation. I was just desperate.
Come on.
Yeah.
I got the revelation
when they said you're healed.
Yes.
I was just tasting.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And it,
was an unfamiliar taste.
Mm-hmm.
It was a new taste. But it was a taste that brought revelation, that brought inspiration, that brought a tangible reality of God in my
life. Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord. The God that was in me just did what come natural to him, and that was heal me.
Yes,
when I came into agreement with him, when I recognized him.
Yes.
If you knew, Nathan, who it is that's in you, you'd ask me.
Yes.
Come on.
That's right.
And I'd heal you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Lord.
That's what he does, and he does it by his word.
Yes.
He and his word are one.
Yes.
Taste and see.
Yes.
That the Lord is good.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Praise God.
Amen, amen. God bless you. You want to pray? We need to pray. Pray the word.
Yes.
Amen. Pray the word over your enemies.
Yes.
Pray the word over your loved ones.
Yes.
Pray the word over your conditions.
Yes.
Amen. Pray the word over your bank account, over your doctor's report, over your lawyers. Pray the word over your spouse. If you got issues, you know, I mean, pray the word over your relationships. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Hallelujah. It'll bring results because it's God. It's God. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. God bless all of you. Love you. Go in the power of his word. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great week, everybody. God bless you.